Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
All right. Got a question for you. You know, we live, and I'll get to your question in a minute. You know, we live life, and we're constantly facing difficult times. We face battles. Though we're of this world, though we're in this world, we're not of this world, but you're in the world. Amen? But Paul wrote to the church and said, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. What's that mean? That means you can't confess it away. The evil day is coming. The Bible doesn't tell you. Now listen, charismatic word of faith, folks. I grew up with you. Amen? I grew up in the Pentecostal Holiness Church. Got born again, baptized in the Holy Ghost in the Pentecostal Holiness Church. Then God called me out, and I went to Rhema Bible Training Center. God moved me, and I came over among the Word of Faith Charismatics. And one of the things that we did in those circles is we began to use confession in ways that the Bible doesn't teach. Hello. Number one, you can't confess Jesus is coming back next week. As, you know, you can only confess that which the Word of God has already given you revelation or proof or truth on to be, that's applicable now. Amen. Amen. Hello? You can't confess your glorified body. Now, I've seen Christians. Listen, I was one of them. I was a cares nutbag. I mean, people come up to me and they find out what I was doing and they weren't saved, but they were trying to be kind. I said, good luck. I say, look, I don't believe in luck. Luck's the root word of Lucifer. You know, my wife would just, well, she was my girlfriend at the time, just walk off and leave me standing there. She was so embarrassed at how stupid acted I was. But I had a lot of zeal and no knowledge. You know, the old folks used to call it wildfire. Got too much wildfire around here. Of course, Brother Hagin said, I'd rather have a little wildfire than, you know, in the move of the God than the order of a graveyard, no move at all. You know, so I get it, you know, but at the same time, we started doing stupid stuff. We started confessing all kinds of stuff. You know, two girls out at my Bible school back before I got there confessed a couple of guys as their husbands. I believe I received so-and-so, and believe I received so-and-so as my husband. You know, one of them went as far as to send out the invitations to buy the wedding dress. Hello. Brother Hagin told that story and said, isn't that right, Doug? Isn't that right, Mark? Mark Bazee and Doug Jones were the targets. Neither one of them married those girls. They had gone out a couple times. You know, they enjoyed going out and having a little fellowship, but they weren't interested. That wasn't who they were interested in marrying, and they didn't marry either one of them. But they were confessing it. And people they would tell them, look, we're not interested in getting married, you know. And they go to their friends and say, I don't receive that. I believe my confession is. See, you can't do that. You can't confess away that evil day. You can't confess away giants coming into your life. Amen. Giants are coming. What does he mean, giants? Circumstances of life will come your way. Amen. You're going to have to encounter. You can't confess them away so they don't ever show up. Amen. I think I heard a choir out there going, hallelujah. No, you can't. We have to understand, because let me tell you something. If you begin to believe that you can confess away the devil, confess away any circumstances, confess things that are never going to happen, when the Bible says put on the armor of God when they show up, God's already told you what you do when it does come. Not keep it from ever coming. What's going to happen is when it shows up, it's going to put your feet where your head was 2 seconds before. And you're not going to know what to do because you're going to go around, well, I thought I confessed that away. I thought I said that wasn't going to happen. And see, and you don't have your armor on because you're not expecting it to show up. Be like the five wise virgins and not the five foolish virgins. That parable is told for a reason. We're to live in preparation. We're to live ready. Put on the whole armor. Ephesians chapter 6. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand. When? In the evil day. Now, the word day there can mean season. See, now let me tell you something, folks. Sometimes, most of the time when the devil shows up, it's not for a quick visit. He's coming to put you down. He's coming to take you down. And you need to be equipped to fight the good fight of faith and to stand your ground in the wind. And having done all to stand therefore, the King James says, I believe it's Phillips' translation said it back when he first, you know, now Phillips had about three translations or versions. His first one he wrote kind of sloppy. He wrote it, and when I say sloppy, he wasn't real concise to the Greek and that kind of stuff. He was a little more free with his, you know, interpretation and stuff. And then people started quoting him. He said, I better go back and clean it up. And so he went back and started cleaning it up and got it a little more, you know, make sure it wasn't as much of a paraphrase, a little cleaner in it. But one of his early versions said this, said, and having done all to stand on the battlefield ready to do battle again. You don't run out and start rejoicing over your victory before the job's done. That's what David did. He killed the one giant and left the other four, took him the rest of his life to take them out. And as a matter of fact, I think we said this last week, at the end of his life, he had to have help killing the last couple. Because he was so old and feeble, he couldn't do it by himself. He had to have help. Yet when he was young, he picked up those five stones. That was not in case he missed four times. Goliath had four brothers. One of them was a six-finger, six-toe giant. You killed my father, prepared to die. Anyway, some of y'all get that, some of you won't. That's okay. Hallelujah. My name is David Ben, you know, David Ben Judah or something, you know. You mocked my God, prepared to die. Anyway, the Princess Diaries, the Princess Bride, you know. I when I first saw that, I said it's the dumbest thing ever put in the film. Took me about 10 years to get past that to, it finally wore on me, you know. And actually, I got to where I actually want to watch it every once in a while. I don't know because it's so stupid I want to watch it or what. Anyway, but there's bad days coming. Now, some of you have probably figured that one out. I thought we were Word of Faith Church. We don't believe in bad days. I don't believe in staying there. But they're coming. And you better be ready. And you better know what to do when they show up. We prepare our soldiers in peacetime, not because we want to go to war, but in preparation when it shows up, we're ready for it. You don't wait till you're in the middle of the war to start training your people how to shoot a gun. Hello? They train on how to break their... Listen, you know that a military soldier has to know how, in the dark, without being able to see, break their weapon down and put it back together in like less than a minute. Why? Because in battlefield at night, you better be able to do that or you're dead. Your life depends on it. You better be ready when the devil shows up. So, my question for you this morning, and let's read from Deuteronomy, and then I'll ask my question when we get to the end of the verse or chapter. We'll pick up, I said Numbers chapter 13. I like Deuteronomy so much, I just want to say Deuteronomy. Numbers chapter 13, we'll read a little bit of the first part, then we'll move on to the bottom end. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, send thou men, that they may search the land of Canaan, which I give unto the children of Israel. Of every tribe of their fathers shall send a man, every one a ruler among them. Now 12 tribes, 12, you know, 12 spies. And Moses, by the commandment of the Lord, sent them from the wilderness of Paran. And all those men were heads of the children of Israel. And he lists all the names. We're not going to go into all that. And verse 17, and Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan and said to them, get ye up this way southward and go into the mountain. See the land, what it is, and the people that dwelleth therein, whether they be strong or weak, few or many. And what the land is that they dwell in, whether it be good or bad, and what the cities be that they dwell in, whether in tents or in strongholds. And the land is, and what the land is, whether it be fat or lean, whether it be wood therein or not. You know, in other words, if it's all forest, you've got to clear all the land to plant. Hello? And be ye of good, and be ye of good courage, and bring of the fruit of the land. Now the time was the time of the first ripe grapes. So they went up and searched the land from the wilderness of Zin and to Rehob, and men to Hamath. And they ascended to the south and came unto Hebron, where Iamon, and Shishai and Talibah. Man, boy, you know, thank God for speaking in tongues. I couldn't read Old Testament names without it. And the children of Anak were there. Now, Hebron was built 7 years before Zoan in Egypt. And they came to the brook of Eshcol and cut down from thence a branch with one cluster of grapes and bare that between two upon a staff. And they brought pomegranates and other figs. Now, I went to the grocery store the other day and got a bag of red seedless grapes. I walked out with it on my finger. It's a cluster. And they were kind of big ones. They weren't the little, they were a little bit bigger. And I had a bag of red seedless grapes and walked out with it on my finger. They took one cluster. It was so heavy they had to put it on a pole and put it in between two men's shoulders and walk with it. And some serious grapes. I said, them some grapes, baby. We're talking about, you know, harvest. Are you here? And the place was called the Brook of Eshcol, because the cluster of grapes with the children of Israel cut down from thence, and they returned from searching the land after 40 days. And they went up and came to Moses and to Aaron and to the congregation of the children of Israel in the wilderness Paran and to Kadesh, and brought back word unto them and to all the congregation, and showed them the fruit of the land. Boy, I'm going to tell you, people are excited. Woo! Look at that one cluster of grapes. I'll feed my family for a month. Hallelujah! And they sold them and said, we came to the land where thou sent us, and surely it floweth with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it. Now, let me tell you something. There's sometimes you just need to shut up. This is the point. They needed to shut up. Right here, where it flows with milk and honey. Here's the fruit of the land. Stop. No one asked for your opinion. Nevertheless, in other words, God said it's going to bring us to a land that flows with milk and honey. Well, that's true, but we've got a problem. Like, God didn't know there were giants in the land. God didn't know there were walled cities in the land. God didn't know that there were enemies in the land. Now, let me say something. God did not let that land lay fallow for 400 years. There were cities built. There were lands that was plowed. There were vineyards that were planted. There were groves that were planted. There was everything ready. It was moving ready. It was a turnkey operation for his children. Turnkey, move in ready. Didn't he have to move the old furniture in? Hallelujah. It was turnkey ready. Glory to God. Can you say hallelujah? Somebody say, God is good. All the time. Not all the time. God is good. And they said, nevertheless, the people be strong in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. And the Amalekites dwell in the land to the south, the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites, and dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and the coast of Jordan. Amen. Thank God we got authority over ites, termites, Jebusites, Canaanites, every other kind of ite. Can you say amen? Now listen. They bring back the good report of what's in the land, of the fruit, and it's flowing milk and honey, but they didn't stop there. They had to go into, oh, yeah, but there are giants. There's walled cities. I mean, all the people we don't like are out there. You know, they're going to take us down. But Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess it. Why? For we are well able to overcome it. He knew who God was. But the men that went up with him said, we be not able to go against the people, for they are stronger than we. God's not interested if your enemy is stronger than you. You know, why? Because he's stronger than the enemy. God is bigger than the enemy. Are you here? He is the Lord and there is none else, praise God. He supersedes all. He's the trump card. Are you here? Amen. When the prophet came out of his tent and all the hosts of the enemy were gathered around him, his servant said, you know, we're in trouble, boss. He said, Lord, open his eyes. He said, for there's more to be with us than be with them, glory to God. Hallelujah. And they saw the armies of the Lord encamped round about them, praise God. And they were kept safe by the power of God, hallelujah. Jesus manifested, hallelujah, in the old covenant, his glory and his power, hallelujah, by coming and standing there. And all those things, I got a friend who fought. Who was from Jordan. Now Fawaz was a guy who grew up, his goal in life was to join the Jordanian Air Force and go bomb the Jews. That's what he wanted to do. And we used to call him the Jordanian Jew Bomber. That was our nickname for him. See, he got born again and came to America and came to Ramah Bible Training Center. But he knew people who fought in the Six-Day War. And they came down there and they were going to take Israel out. But when they showed up, these people told them, said, we were there, we fought. When we got there on the dunes were millions of people. said, we couldn't win. They got their back end kicked. Not only did they not gain any land, they lost land. Why? Because God is bigger than the enemy, praise God. Hallelujah. His hand and protection, his covenant doesn't fade. He is the God that keepeth covenant unto 1,000 generations. Hallelujah. Can you shout glory? Hallelujah. Praise be to God forever. He keeps his eye. He keeps his word. God cannot fail. Hallelujah. And Caleb says, hey, shut up. Stop talking about how big the people are. We're well able to go take the land.
But we be not able.
You can't afford the weenie mindset. You can't afford to be defeated. You can't afford to be defeated in your mind. Are you here? You got to have victory in your mind. You got to overcome in your mind. Hallelujah. You got to know that God is bigger than your enemy. God is bigger than your battle. God is bigger than your circumstance. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And they brought, and so we've been not able, for the people stronger than we, and they brought up an evil report. God said their report is evil. Not that they were facing something big, but they were sitting, here's where they got into trouble. You know, you can recognize that the enemy is there. You can recognize that there is trouble there. You can recognize that he's come against you. But the evil report was, they're stronger than we. It's going to take us down. We can't overcome. That's the evil report. God did not bring them up to let them die. Hallelujah. Listen to this. They brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, the land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof. How do they know that? They all came back. That said, they all came back. Not any of them got left behind. How do they know that land eateth? They were just assuming that because those cities were walled, they had giants in the land, that they were going to get eat up when they showed up for battle. And all the people we saw are men of great stature. And we saw the giants, the son of Anak, and came to the, and which came with the giants. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers. And so we were in their sight. Now let me tell you something. Later in the scripture, when Israel finally got into the promised land, you know what they asked them? What took y'all so long? For 40 years they had heard that God had brought them out of Egypt. For 40 years, they were sitting around. They couldn't enjoy dinner because the Israelites are going to show up any minute. For 40 years, you know, they go out to till their garden. And they think they might be coming across the hill right now. They can't enjoy it. Because they knew that the God, they had heard the stories, how that the God of Israel had come and brought them out of Egypt with a strong hand, glory to God. Can you say amen? God did not bring you out of the kingdom of darkness and translate you into the kingdom of his dear son to leave you destitute, to leave you defeated, to leave you out, glory to God. He brought you out of that kingdom to bring you into his kingdom, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of blessing, the kingdom of overcoming, hallelujah, the kingdom of victory, praise God, the kingdom of his dear son, praise God. It's the kingdom of light, glory to God. Can you shout glory? Hallelujah. God did not bring you out. You're not born again to be defeated. You're not born again to fail. You're not born again to go under. You're the head and not the tail, above only and not beneath. You go forward under the blood-stained banner of the victory march of the Lord Jesus Christ, who has overcome the kingdom of darkness. Hallelujah. And now we walk by faith and not by sight. And I haven't gotten to any point yet. It's in my notes. Next week. But we march under the banner of Jehovah Nissi, the Lord our captain of victory. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is our captain. Jesus has produced our victory. Hallelujah. And by the power of God we win. Book of Revelation. John gets so excited. Looking at the victory procession of heaven, looking at the great saints, hallelujah. He just shouts out and says, and they overcame. How, John? How did they overcome?
by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. Hallelujah. What is their testimony? Their confession that Jesus is Lord. Jesus is their captain. Jesus is their victor. Hallelujah. And we walk in that victory through faith in God, faith in his word, faith in what Jesus accomplished for us. Hallelujah. The enemy is defeated. God is exalted. And Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah. And now we, the occupying army, establish our victory in every arena of life. He did not bring... The New Testament writer says, how shall he who spared not his own son not also with him freely give us all things? If he sent Jesus to redeem you, he's not going to bring you out and then send you down the tubes. He's not going to run over your kids. He's not going to slap your wife with cancer. He's not going to put the devil's... Jesus made it clear. The thief cometh not but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I have come. The antithesis. I have come that they might have Zoe and have it to the full, or have it more abundantly. Have it to the full in fullness. Zoe. Life in the manner that God has it. The life that the Father has in himself, that he gave to the incarnate Son to have in himself, and now he has given to the church through the new birth. Hallelujah. God has not brought you out. God did not bring you out of Egypt to let you die in the wilderness. And he's not bringing you into the promised land to have you crushed by the giants. He has given you all things that pertain to life and godliness. You're equipped with everything you have need of to win. Say, I'm a winner. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We had 10 spies. Now we know later we find out Joshua sided in with Caleb. Okay? The 10 spies said, nevertheless. And when Caleb said, let us go up at once and get the land. Nope. The people are strong. They'll eat us. We're not able to go up against them. Caleb had said, we're well able. But they said, we're grasshoppers in our sight. Therefore, we're grasshoppers in their sight. When they realized that their defense of faith had departed from them, they were fair game. And Satan's out to steal your faith. I said, Satan's out to rob your faith. Satan's out to pull it out of your heart. So we got to stay in the Word. We got to stay in faith. We got to stay full of faith in the Holy Ghost. One of the things we don't do enough in our charismatic circles is we don't pray in tongues enough. Amen. No, we just lost me. I don't believe in that stuff. Well, just stay with me. Don't run off. I could sit down with you 10 minutes and show you from the Bible that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is a separate experience of the new birth. I can show it to you from Scripture. I can prove it to you without any trouble at all. If you would study the Bible with an open heart, you would too. You'd find it without even having to show it to you. We know in one place they had been baptized in water in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they sent Peter and John down there to get them baptized in the Holy Ghost. Laid hands on them that the Holy Ghost might come on them. For as yet they had been baptized only in the name of Jesus. They came to lay hands on them so they'd get the Holy Ghost. It can't be the same thing as getting born again. But Jude said, but ye, beloved, building up yourselves in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Now people come along and say, that's fervent prayer. Well, if you go back to 1 Corinthians, chapters 12, 13, and 14. If I pray in the Spirit, my spirit prayeth. My spirit, and as Amplified Bible says, my spirit by the Holy Spirit prayeth. We got to keep our faith strong. We got to stay built up in our faith. We can't let it wane. We can't let it depart from us. Why? Because there's giants in the land. And Israel was supposed to go drive the giants out. Now, the reason they spent 40 years in the wilderness was not not what God wanted to develop them. Because they didn't go in here. They were never supposed to be in the wilderness. They're supposed to march across, go across, walk in, take over. It was their place. Instead, because they didn't go in, you know, God's anger comes down. They're in trouble. Are you here? The congregation lifted up their voice and cried, and the people wept that night, and all the children of Israel murmured against Moses. I'll tell you right now, as soon as it don't go right, it's the preacher's fault. He said, if I do this, that's what happened. It's the preacher's fault. Nope. Against Moses and Aaron, the whole congregation said to them, would God that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would God we had died in this wilderness. And they got exactly what they wanted. Because every one of them except Joshua and Caleb and people under 20 died there. That generation died in the wilderness. Would to God. You better be careful what would to God you put out there. Because they died in that wilderness. Everybody say that's stupid. And wherefore hath the Lord brought us up into this land to fall by the sword, and our wives and our children should be prey? Were it not better for us to return into Egypt? And they said, let us return. Make a captain. Return to Egypt. And Moses and Aaron fell on the faces of all the assembly of the congregation of the children of Israel, and Joshua the son of Nun. You ever heard that little story? Which Old Testament character didn't have a mom or dad? Joshua the son of Nun. All right, anyway. Caleb, Dick, there you go. That's a Friday thing for you. And Joshua the son of Nun, Caleb the son of Jephunneh, which were of them, and searched the land, rent their clothes, and they spake unto the congregation, said, the land which we pass through is exceeding good land. The Lord delight in us. Then he will bring us into the land and give it to us, land that flows with milk and honey. Only rebel ye not against the Lord, neither fear ye the people of the land, for they are bread for us. Their defense is departed from them, and the Lord is with them. Fear them not. They still got a chance here. But all the congregation bade stone them. So they're going to kill them for talking faith. Oh, my God, things have not changed a bit. You start talking faith and start saying what the word says, and people will be ready to kill you. They'll sacrifice you on the altar of religious political correctness. Hello? They'll call you a name it, claim it, frame it, blab it, and grab it. Hello? Are you here? The name it, claim it, frame it bunch. The blab it and grab it front bunch. You know? All kinds of stuff. And the glory, listen, they're getting ready to kill Caleb and Joshua. And the glory of the Lord appeared in the tabernacle congregation before all the children of Israel. And the Lord said to Moses, how long will this people provoke me? And how long will it be ere they believe me? For all the signs which I have shown among them, I'll smite them with pestilence and disinherit them, and will make them make of thee a greater nation and a mightier than they. Now Moses steps in and intercedes for them. Now later Moses is ready to wipe them out himself. But at this point in time, he intercedes for them. And God withdraws his anger because he's about ready to take them out. Hello? He already worked all those miracles. Brought them out. Splits the Red Sea. Drowns all the armies of the Egyptians. Hello? They have a Holy Ghost shout down. They sing Miriam's song. I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and the rider are thrown into the sea. I mean, that's what we call Miriam's song. That's the song they sang at the banks. There you go. That's where it came from. We sing in the charismatic church. We're just, my Lord, my God, my strength, my song, has now become my victory. And we all sing that song. Father's God, and I will praise him. But it's Miriam's song because the whole Egyptian army just got killed. They get over and find there's giants in the land now. They're ready to, you know, same thing Elijah did. Killed all the prophets. Now, oh, I'm the only one left. Ain't nobody but me. I mean, he was trying out for hee-haw. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. Because the harlot said she was going to kill him. I mean, he's like, kill him. Come on. God's showing himself 1 second. Well, himself strong 1 second, and you encounter another battle, and you're going, weenie fire? Just because another battle showed up? Hello? No, we just see here, like I said, we don't need to be stomping and relishing in the victory. We need to be ready for the next battle. Because Satan will always come with a counterattack. We don't preach this in our circles much. There are counterattacks. Right when you think everything's got it, you got it, it's all hunky-dory, you the greatest thing about faith and power since, Wigglesworth was here. I mean, as a matter of fact, you could write his book for him because you know so much. And then here it comes. If you're not ready, hello, you got to stay ready. You cross the Red Sea, now there's giants in the Promised Land. There might be giants in the Promised Land, but the guy that split the Red Sea and drowned the Egyptians is going before you to bring you out with a strong arm. I said, hallelujah. He knew they were there. He had all that stuff that, man, think about it. How would you like to pack up and move out west? You know, everybody's going to move out west and show up somewhere, and there's houses and lands and vineyards and groves and water just flowing through there, and all you got to do is move in. Why did that? I mean, came out west where it's going to be rough. No, there's a whole city here. They came out of Egypt where they worked under the whip for 400 years and get out there and run into a little problem. They want to go back. Your flesh is no place to run back to. Hello? The things you've sought refuge in before you came to Christ are not an answer. They weren't an answer before. They're not an answer now. He is my refuge, my fortress, a strong tower. Hallelujah. But we've done a disservice to people we've ministered to because we haven't told them to be ready for the battle. We've told them, we just make the confession. We say whatever and we're victorious. Your confession is your battle plan. Your confession is your destiny. But you're still going to have to fight the battle and win. You're going to have to fight the good fight of faith. You're going to have to look the devil eyeball to eyeball, toenail to toenail, nose to nose, and say, no. You're not proceeding any further. As a matter of fact, I'm coming to the enemy's camp. And I'm taking back what he took from me. Hallelujah. I will defeat you here by the power of God. I am not a grasshopper. I am not a grasshopper in my sight, and I know I'm not in yours, because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? Oh, glory be to God. The victory that overcomes the world is my faith. And God has dealt for me the measure of faith. And my faith groweth exceedingly, praise God. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? Because faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Amen. It's ever increasing. Hallelujah. It's getting stronger every day. Amen. I win. Amen. What if you have a setback during the march? I win. Do you understand? In war, there are times you may look like you're getting pushed back. It may look like the enemy is advancing. It may look like the enemy has the upper hand. But then I want you to know something, glory be to God, that this is the victory that overcometh the world, even my faith, glory to God. Hallelujah. I overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of my testimony. Hallelujah. I'm more than a conqueror through him that loved me, praise God. Hallelujah. Death, nor life, nor principality of power, nor things present, nor things to come are going to separate me from the love of God. Hallelujah. I win. You got to declare your end. You got to have your eye on the goal. If you're playing football and you don't know which end is your goal, you're in trouble. You can turn around and run the wrong way and score for the other team. And it wouldn't be a touchdown. No, it'd be a safety. Okay, I get it. It was still scoring for the other team. You got to keep your eye on the prize, and you declare, this is my end. I will not be defeated. Pastor Hagin said, I will not be defeated, and I will not quit. You can't quit in the middle of the battle. Her preacher said one time, he said, look,
He said, when you're going through hell, don't stop. He says some Christians get out the picnic lunch, set up a table, and just sit there in the middle of hell. No, you keep going. You keep going. Why? Until you come out. Amen. Satan's looking to take you down. God's got a promise out of it, but Satan will try to dissuade you from the possibility of you having the promise by sending giants to your land so that you'll give up instead of possessing. Hallelujah. We don't give up. Paul wrote in the book of Hebrews. I believe Paul wrote Hebrews, okay? You may not agree with that. Don't say anything. It's just a matter. It's an opinion, okay? I wonder who, doop, boop, boop, who wrote the book of Hebrews? I believe Paul did. I believe it completes his revelation. Now, you may not. I don't care. You may think somebody else is. You may not care that I don't. That's fine. We don't have any proof who wrote it. I just believe that he did. All right? Hallelujah. And he says in Hebrews chapter 10, he said, we are not of them which draw back. Amen. Look over there, Hebrews 10. And we're going to close right here because we got, somebody say glory. All right, be Polish. Glorioski. Oh, come on, guys. Hebrews 10:38. Now the just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of them which draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. We're not those that draw. We're not of them that draw. We're not. We are of them that sit in the grandstands of heaven, that great company of believers. See, we're compassed about by such a great cloud of witnesses. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. See, we're compassed about by a great cloud of witnesses. Hallelujah. Let us look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Glory to God. We're to keep pressing in. We're to keep going forward. We're to keep winning. We're to keep standing on the Word. We're to keep looking at us the way. Let me tell you something. When you see yourself the way that you are in the natural, or the way that the enemy wants you to be, you will become defeated. We were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. That's why you're to renew your mind to the Word of God, so you see yourself the way God does, as the overcomer, as the winner, as the head, not the tail, as above only and not beneath. Glory to God, the winner. Amen. As a child of God, heir of God, joint heir with Jesus Christ. Praise God. That's what God has called us to. Can somebody say glory?
Glory.
Hallelujah. And with that, I did not make my first point. So next week, we'll try to get point one. Can somebody say hallelujah?
Hallelujah?
Father, we honor you. We bless your name. We magnify the King and Lord of all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord said that someone watching right now, there's a problem in your right ear. And just reach out by faith and say, I receive healing now in Jesus' name. Jesus is your healer. Hallelujah. Be healed in the name of Jesus. There's no distance in the Spirit. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost is bigger than the distance between where you are and where I am. But the Holy Spirit said there's someone with it right in your right ear. You got something going on that's a problem. And the Lord says you're healed in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? Amen. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Someone has been dealing with acute migraine headaches. Hallelujah. I don't know if that's there or here. I don't know. But I tell you, the Lord says be healed. Hallelujah. Migraines go. Be whole in the name of Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Now that's called the word of knowledge. God knows all things. And the manifestation of gifts of healings, where he ministers healing in conjunction with the word of knowledge. Hallelujah. Now I don't have to lay hands on you. And we can lay hands on the sick. The Bible says lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. But you know what? The command of faith by the unction of the Holy Ghost. People used to basically almost crucify Oral Roberts because he would
put his hand up to the camera and say, stretch your hand out and touch your television set right now. It wasn't because there was any power in that television set. It wasn't so there was some transcendent power that allowed his hand to actually be there in their television set. It was a point of contact for them to release their faith. God showed him that. And he didn't care. People got healed. The naysayers, we don't care about naysayers. We care about ministering to those who have need. The naysayers can sit out there and they say all they want to. They just won't get nothing. But if we can reach people and they get their need met by the power of God, because Jesus loves them so much, he'll have us be on the internet and be on television and have it so they can get what they need because it came into their home. Hallelujah. Then he'll reach people. And they say all you want to. God loves people. He loves the sick and the infirm and wants to minister his life to them. Hallelujah. God loves you. God's for you. God's on your side. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, Rabba Sukra Badia Kamada. Meredabufa Tariete Kasikita Ganukoskut, Gibra Konoske Kamadigiska. Veskla Kamale Udaribukuta Brata Bere, Fresco de Liamato Sotre de Veta Bada Badi Kutu Sutre de Menene, Usutre Ekabala Kodutsikrekeme. Hear ye well. Hear well the word of the Lord. For the days of the past and the struggles of the past are not the voice of your future, says the Lord. That which I have spoken and that which I have decreed unto you is that which I have ordained you should walk in. Your future is bright. Your future is glorious. Your future is walking with me, says the Lord, in the fullness of my purpose for your life. So no longer look to the past to try to figure out your future. Look to me once again. And that which I stated from the beginning, even as I spoke to my servant Abraham and said, go to the place that I will show you. Come again to me, and I will show you your destiny. I'll show you your purpose, and you'll walk in it. You'll fulfill it, and it'll be a blessed and glorious time as you walk out with me. Will there be any trouble? Yeah, you'll encounter things. But as you look to me, that which brought you down in the past, you'll step over in victory. You'll step over in authority. You'll step over in the power of my might. And you'll run the race without being encumbered as in time past, but you'll run freely. You'll run victoriously. You'll run gloriously in me, says the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Here, online, I don't know. General, take it. Just reach up and say, it's mine. I take it now. Hallelujah. We love you. We love those watching. We love you here. Father, be anybody watching. Anyone here today that's not born again. There'd be those that are backslid. Those that aren't baptized in the Holy Ghost. Those that are struggling in life. We thank you. You minister to them right now in Jesus' name. For those of you that need to be born again, just pray with me now. Say, dear Father, I come to you in Jesus' name. I confess Jesus as my Lord. I believe you've raised him from the dead. And I receive salvation now. Father, I've been backslid. I come now and confess my sin before the throne of God and ask that the blood of Jesus, your Son, cleanses me from all unrighteousness. Restore me to full fellowship with you in Jesus' name. And dear God, I pray and ask you for the gift of the Holy Spirit. I believe I receive the infilling of the Spirit in the name of Jesus and believe I speak in tongues in the name of Jesus. Amen. Go ahead right where we are. If you're home, go ahead. Receive. We command health and healing to spring forth. Receive Jesus as your healer now. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. If you're watching us, please, you can even on the feed, just comment. I just received Jesus. Go to our webpage, email us. Tell us who you are. Give us the address. We'll contact you. Anything you had need of. Email us, text us, whatever we got, information we got out there. Contact us, whatever way we need, you need to. Let us know. We want to communicate with you. If you're in another place, we know a lot of good churches. We know a lot of good churches. We can get you connected. If you're here, come be with us. If you're in Greensboro area, Piedmont Triad of North Carolina, come on out and be with us. If you're in another area and you can't get over here, we'll get you connected to a good church. We know good churches all over. Hallelujah. You need to be in a good place. Amen. We love you. Love those here present, those here watching us. We love you. God bless you. Till we meet again, remember, this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Amen. Hallelujah. Can you say glory?
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.